signed a bill banning gender-affirming treatment,
passing a sweeping anti-trans bill.
This bill is the farthest-reaching anti-trans legislation in the entire country.
Anti-trans obsession on the right.
People who are long-time transgenders who lived as such, and they're also much more likely to commit sex crime.
It seems like both are a real problem.
There can be no middle way in dealing with transgenderism. It is all or nothing.
On the right, it will be day in and day out of them talking about, oh, these deviants are trying to groom your children into being LGBTQ.
Matt Walsh has become an expert to the right wing about gender and trans issues.
If we're talking about the drugs, it's, I mean, millions.
You're talking about hormone blockers.
Millions? How did you do a whole documentary on this? And you're not, you're like four orders of magnitude off. Millions of kids on puberty blockers? Millions?
Yeah.
Millions of kids have been on hormone blockers, really?
I'm sure someone's going to fact check me on that. But my guess is that we're into the millions now at this point. Yeah, that would be my guess.
It says over the last 5 years, there were at least 4,780 adolescents who started puberty blockers and had a prior gender dysphoria diagnosis.
It says it's kind of undercounted, but that's...
That would be a big undercounting.
Less than 1,000 people a year.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I would guess, you know, hundreds of thousands at this, but I could be wrong.
You did a whole documentary on this, didn't you? How do you not have any background information at all about any of this? Did you do any reading, any research, anything at all?
It truly shows what your state of mind is and how disconnected you are from reality, if that's what you feel. I think you're a little bit disconnected, buddy. Millions of children on puberty blockers?
Gender-affirming double mastectomies in that time frame.
And when you say girls, you're talking about prepubescent?
Right, minors.
Did you see how slickly he slipped that in?
Talking about prepubescent?
Right. Minors.
At face value, this doesn't make sense. Prepubescent girls who almost never have breasts are having their breasts removed? That's really weird. But then he slips in, right, these are minors.
Is there a moment of extending a hand? I think no, there's not.
Canada, transgenderism will soon be the justification for suspending all freedom of speech.
You have to ban transgenderism entirely. Can't just ban it for the kids. It's got to be entirely.
Right-wingers are obsessed. This is what they call a culture war.
Transgenderism must be eradicated from public life entirely.
On the same day, a group of 31 people affiliated with the white nationalist group Patriot Front were arrested near a pride parade. They had masks, riot shields, and at least one smoke grenade. Police say they were planning to start a riot at that pride event.
So I have a question. Do you think there's a difference between actively hating somebody and not caring about somebody?
Yeah, of course.
All right. So if that's the case, I think the argument you would say is conservatives don't care about trans people, but I don't think they necessarily hate them, right?
Because you can say that, but argument is probably something that
actually,
I hate.
Do you by hate, do you mean consequentially or in intention?
When I say hate, what I mean is when it feels like, especially when we have trans youth, it feels like conservatives are less interested in exploring which options would be the most beneficial for people that identify as trans in their youth. And they're more interested in axing all medical care or availability or accessibility from these people completely. And they do it from like an ideological background, not from a what's the best thing to do for this type of person background, which is why I think they hate trans people and they're not just like trying to protect kids.
Yeah. Well, then I have a question. Do you think they, when they say like, I think it's stupid as f*** when they say, all right, the way to deal with this is say, all right, don't use gender-affirming care. Go with the guidelines we've always had, right? Because like that, you wouldn't treat a schizophrenic patient like that. You wouldn't treat a dementia patient like that, right? However, if you necessarily believe that if you go to this gender ideology, society will be destroyed, and it's not good for that person either, in your mind, thinking that, why would you ever go to the different ideology?
Yeah, but isn't that like a form of hatred? Like, so for instance, if you, let's say that you believe that like gay people would destroy society. If gay people get married, it's going to lead to the degradation of society and all of our values are going to be destroyed. Wouldn't you consequentially then like hate gay people because they're like destructive for society?
That's why I asked in the beginning, or say consequentially or an intention, right?
Well, I feel like I feel like it kind of bleed over, right?
Because in that case,
let's say that I go by your definition that it's just like you consequentially end up hating somebody. Wouldn't by that argument nobody hate anybody ever? Because if you hate anybody, it's just because consequentially.
Because like KKK members, it's like, oh yeah, I want to hang that. Right? There are people who actually want to kill those people, right? Versus with trans people, it doesn't seem they necessarily actively want to kill those people. They
sure, but do you need to want to kill somebody for it to qualify as hatred? There's a lot of people I hate that I wouldn't kill.
There's a lot of people you hate that you wouldn't kill.
I think you can hate somebody without wanting to kill them, right?
Like, what's the strength of the word hate then, right? Because I think there's a difference between disliking somebody and hating somebody, right? So, like,
well, if I said conservatives dislike trans people, when I say hate trans people, what I mean is conservatives don't seem to have in mind what would be best for people that identify as trans. Rather, their goal is to get rid of it completely. They want to erase it as much as possible, which in my feeling is that's like, to be basically, you hate trans people. You're not trying to do anything to alleviate any of their issues or make the world better for them. You just hate them.
But if they think by going like whatever Christianity, whatever the fuck they think, right? Mm-hmm. That is going to help people, right? However insane it might be, the intention is we think this is going to help them, right?
Yeah. But I mean, but again, like, help them by making them not trans, right?
Yeah, by making them,
which I feel like is like a form of hatred of like trans people, right?
But that's a really consequential. If you say consequentially they hate trans people, I 100% agree with you. But to say like, all right, they have intent, like they actively want to. And by we say, like, when we say get rid of trans people, like, are we talking about, like, killing? Or are we talking about, like, you're not allowed to get gender identity?
Well, it feels like for a lot of the proposed legislation, Jesus, there's, like, so many different states now where the state assemblies are trying to get legislation to, like, for instance, like, take trans children from their parents as a form of, like, child abuse, to, like, out trans children as much as possible, to bar them from getting any sort of gender-affirming care whatsoever. Like,
100%, because if you think that gender-affirming care is, one, going to lead to, like, what you think is the mutilation of genitals, or what you think is the destruction of society.
Yeah.
You think it would be best for them and everyone.
I agree. But those things are all things you hate. You would hate the destruction of society. You would hate mutilation of children. You would hate them.
Wait. Hating the something that results of them and hating the actual people that are trans are two different things, right?
Yeah, I guess. I understand what you're saying. I feel like with that definition of hatred, I feel like conservatives, like, or people in general, it's hard to say you hate anybody.
I think, yeah, but that's because, like, the bar for hate is so high, right?
Is it really?
Just because we think of hate, I'm thinking, all right, I see the Jews, they need to go. And they need to be lampshades. That's what I think.
What about people that, like, hate their professors? Are they just using the word incorrectly?
Yeah, they're using the word incorrectly. They're just fucking.
So for you, you define hate as, like, hate is I want to go and actually kill somebody.
Yes. Well, not even kill somebody. Like, I actually want to harm that person.
Well, right? Harm, I mean, is, you could argue that barring children from getting, like, sorts of, like, gender-affirming care is, like, a form of harm, right? If people always say suicidal,
I think it would lead to harm, but it wouldn't be direct harm itself, right? Because there's a step between, all right, I tell this person they want to kill themselves, and then they actually kill themselves. Would you say, like, convincing somebody to do suicide is the same as, like, first-degree murder?
It's not the same, but they're definitely, like, levels of harm. If you tell a diabetic, type 1 diabetic, that he's not allowed to have access to exogenous insulin anymore, and then he dies, like, you're not directly harming him, but I mean, like, you kind of are. And isn't it kind of similar here? Like, you're just blocking hormones instead of insulin to somebody that might need them?
But the question is, what is doing the harm? Is the people saying you can't get the insulin, right? Because, like, as much as I would love it to be, insulin doesn't occur naturally in nature. Somebody has to make it, somebody has to do it, right? There's a difference between saying, all right.
Sure, but I'm just saying that by that definition then, so if I go and I steal somebody's insulin from them and they can't inject themselves.
Well, and you die directly, right? Because you directly stole something that was theirs. But saying—
Let's say that I passed legislation to make so that insulin is now illegal for people. You don't think that's a form of harm against, like, diabetics?
A form of harm? I'm not sure. Because, like, when you say, like, they're forgetting harming diabetics, right? Would you say, like, in the past, where we didn't have insulin, those diabetics were being harmed by insulin not existing?
Yeah.
So just—
There's not somebody harming them. There's just, like, a general harm they're suffering. But now you've got, like, now if you have the ability to have insulin, right? Like, for instance, let's say that you're starving to death on an island.
Yes.
You're kind of being harmed by starving to death, but nobody's actually harming you. But now let's say that somebody's, like, got food for you, but then they don't let you have any of it. Well, you're still starving, but now somebody else is kind of enacting a harm on you.
But that implied that my food, that their food I could have to begin with, right? Like,
sure.
If, like, there are thousands of hungry kids in the third world dying, right? Like, nobody necessarily hates those people, but they're not going to send, like, the extra 100 bonus they got or, like, extra PPP loans to those
people. Kind of, but we do consider some moral responsibility for Western countries for feeding these nations. There's a ton of charity that, especially the United States, engages in when it comes to, like, donating food, donating medical supplies. So you've got Doctors Without Borders, UNICEF, you've got, like, all these, like, large international NGOs and other charitable organizations try to donate money because we felt like we have some obligation to it, right?
Not necessarily, right? I think it's just because it makes people feel good, just like with the missionary, right? They'll tell you in church, go help the poor, and then they'll go do the missionaries and come back, right? I don't think that's necessarily accepting responsibility. I think that's going above and beyond, right?
I mean, I would agree that it's going above and beyond, but it's just because of like the distance, like getting food to somebody like that is so much harder. Like you're going really above and beyond. I would agree. But like if it's local, I think that like people would consider that like a harm, because we have kind of collectively like a responsibility to, you know, enact a government that's like representing and helping like most of the people. So for instance, like if you weren't giving food to a homeless guy on the street, people would be like, eh, whatever. But if you're not giving food to your child, people say like, okay, well, hold on. Like your child is your responsibility. And then if we've got a government, we've got a medical system. If you've got people that are actively like suffering and they could have access to some drug like a hormone, and we have the ability to provide it, which we do, but you're making laws saying no, you can't have that, then I think people say, well, that is the responsibility of our medical system, we should be able to do that.
Well, I would say like, I mean, I don't know, because when you say like that's a parent having like a parent-child relationship, you think the government and the citizens are a parent-child relationship? I think it's the government's job to do what they're represented, right? So like,
yeah, but if we're making laws to ban, we're using the government to get in between healthcare practitioners and trans youth, right? We're using the government to say no, you can't do that. Yeah. So that I don't know how you can interpret that besides some form of harm, unless you don't believe trans people are real or you hate them.
No, I don't believe trans people are real. Body dysmorphia is fucking crazy. That's wild, right? However, if I have like a specific medical care, right? It's not, we don't have a medical system, right? Like when they say healthcare is a human right, well, hold on, that has not been determined by the citizens yet, right?
Sure.
So if healthcare is not a human right and we're doing that, why would we have a responsibility to cater to like a specific population, right? Because like,
it's just that right now it's not about catering to a specific population. It's the idea that like we have the ability for our medical system to address some of these issues, but conservatives want to use the government to say you're not allowed to do that.
Because they're the one that's the government. You're not.
They want to tell the government you can't have these medical treatments if you're a minor.
Yes. But then again, it gets the fundamental issue, right? Is saying like you can't have this necessarily harm versus like, well, harm consequentially. I agree with you in consequence. Mm-hmm. Like, I think you're 100% right. But just because somebody says, all right, I'm blocking this off for you, doesn't mean they necessarily mean to harm that person, right? Because they, let's say,
I mean, they might not mean to, but I mean, again, like, you can argue the same thing with, like, gay marriage. Like, oh, like, we're banning gay marriage because we think that it's a sin, but we're not harming gay people. We're just doing what's best for them. I mean, like, in that lens, you could say that nothing is harmful, right?
The separation of church and state would kick in, right?
Well, I mean, not until 2012. Fuck, when was gay marriage?
Yeah, it took a while to convince the people, but it eventually happened where he's like, we were discussing as citizens.
Sure, I'm just saying that, like, if there's medicine can provide something, people can need something, and the government gets in the way and says, you're not allowed to do this.
Yes.
That just seems like harm. There's harm coming out at the end of the day to those people then.
And I agree with you. There's harm consequentially, right? But when you say they hate the people, right, that implies intention that they want to harm those people.
Okay.
But if you don't care, there's a difference between like, all right, I'm going to actively bomb citizens in Ukraine versus,
sure,
right,
I don't care. I don't know if people, a conservative, who try to actively kill trans people, probably not, but yeah.
Yeah.
But I think that bar for harm is way too high for me, I think. So.
You think that bar?
Or that bar for hate is way too high for me, I think, but yeah.
All right.
Okay.
I don't know. I generally disagree with like the strength of words being weakened. I don't like this fake weight where it's like, just like with systemic racism and racism, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference between like a racist person who actually wants to lynch somebody and like a racist person like who doesn't want black people in their company. Those are like two different people.
Yeah, I agree.
Structural, and just like in that, right? The intent has to be there for the hate to be there, right? That was just for the trans people versus like there's somebody who actually wants to kill trans people versus somebody who like doesn't care if trans people get hit in the process or not.
Sure, I kind of agree with that, yeah. But I would still say it can count as hateful. But I mean, I understand there are differences to levels of hate for sure, yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah, that's reasonable.
Well, thanks a lot, buddy.
I need you.
Yeah, have fun.
Prompt over there about trans people with conservatives was interesting because I think that there are definitely a lot of very hateful people.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's hateful people on both sides. I think that you'll definitely find a small clump of ultra right wing conservative people who may have some hate in their hearts for trans people. But I also am from the opinion that, so we were actually just talking about this in my English class recently about a school who they were really open with, you know, no gender conforming stereotypes with kids, the way they're introduced, right? And then we were like going back and forth about it. And I think that if like a conservative person who's maybe they're religious, maybe they just have very, you know, conservative family ideals, you know, they want a nuclear family, they don't want divorce, they want their kids to have stereotypical gender roles. I think that there's nothing wrong with trying to maybe force your kids in a little bit towards going towards a gender as opposed to being trans, but obviously
When it comes to parents educating their children, I think you have an obligation as a parent to, you know, bestow upon your children the values that you believe in. I don't think there's a problem with that. When I think about conservatives and their approach to trans people, I think my issue is that instead of looking for solutions that would make trans people's lives the best that they could be, it feels like they're just trying to shut down everything constantly. Like, I think if I would just, if I was to talk to a conservative and I was to ask, for instance, like, let's say that we have the perfect therapist that could determine every child that was really trans versus ones that were just confused, do you think that those children should be allowed to have access to, like, puberty blockers or gender affirming care of other types? I feel like even at that, most conservatives, I think, would still say no. So when I look at that, I guess when I think of, I think there are some problems with the model of care that we've kind of got in the United States when it comes to trans people. I think it is a little bit too much on the affirmation side. But my default is never like, we should take all of it away. It should be, we should keep researching, keep doing studies, figure out, well, like, what's the best way to ameliorate the problems that trans children have, rather than get rid of all of it and out them to their parents and then take them from their parents as child abuse.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. But on the opposing side of that, I think that for you to, like, leave it up to the kids, right? And you're going to try to help them if you, like you said, you have the perfect therapist, right? But the problem is today that there are no perfect therapists, and you have a situation per se where someone's heavily influenced by, you know, they see social media, they see it being accepted a lot, they see it being accepted by their schools and by their friends and people in public. And maybe then you have a kid who naturally would not be a transgender who maybe thinks, maybe this is for me. And, you know, statistically, like, you see a lot of people who have, who are transgender, have that type of, just that type of area, you know, I don't know the terms for it, but you see that statistically as they get older, these type of people do tend to have...
Oh, they're called desisters, I think, right? People that desist, not detransitioners, but people that feel like they might be trans, but then as they get older, they lose those feelings.
But just like in general, I feel like people who are transgender, they have a more probability as they get older for mental illness.
Okay, sure.
That can happen, you know what I mean? It's just like statistically there.
Sure, I understand all of that, and I don't even necessarily disagree with most of what you're saying, but again, I think the issue is that, like, when we say, like, social factors can influence children to believe in certain things that it might not necessarily be true, that's true of everything. True of, like, it could be true of ADHD, it could be true of depression, it could be true of all sorts of other mental illnesses that are treated with medication, but I don't think we would ever say, well, I don't think most people would say, like, okay, because a lot of this relies on self-reporting, because a lot of it could be social influence, we need to take all of it away. No more ADHD medication for kids, no more medication for depression, no more any treatment for anything, because somebody might be influenced. The goal on that would be, like, to get a therapist that can figure out, like, what's real versus what's just, like, a phase. But I never hear conservatives talk about that ever. It seems like it's always like it all needs to go. Teachers need to out trans kids to their parents. We need to get rid of all of the trans care, all of the puberty blockers is horrible and wrong. People like Matt Walsh are making up numbers saying millions of kids are on puberty blockers and stuff. It just seems to come from a place of, and I feel like trans people realize this, that, like, it doesn't come from a place of, like, care and compassion and concern. Like, conservatives try to represent it sometimes. It just comes from a place of, like, I hate trans people and I just want them to all go away. That's what it feels like, I guess, when I listen to it.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I can see that, I do think, though, that, like, I know this wasn't really your original topic, but we're talking about, like, kids.
Yeah, go for it. Knock yourself out. Yeah,
the way they're influenced and everything. I think that for the general population, it's probably better if the idea of being trans or our social gender roles and everything were kind of left out and not... They weren't shown that yet until they're mature enough to really understand their own sexuality, gender identity, and everything. Because if you have an 8-year-old kid who, you know, he sees that boys are playing with trucks and girls are playing with dolls, he's not thinking about gender roles. But then if you introduce him and say, you know, there aren't really any specific genders you have to conform to, you know, you can be whatever you want. I think that in the long run, when you're showing kids that as opposed to traditional gender roles, that might have a more of a negative lasting impact on their mental illness.
I understand what you're saying, but I feel like societally, I feel like we push a lot of gendered stuff onto kids, even from very early ages without realizing it. I want to use a triggering word. Have you ever heard the word heteronormative?
No, I'm not familiar with that term.
There's like... So, like, let's say that you're watching a movie, okay? You're watching a movie, a husband and a wife walk in, they give each other a kiss, and then they start talking to people. Yeah. Like, people see that scene and nobody thinks about it. Nobody's ever asking, like, why are they heterosexual? Why would they do that? But if two guys come in and they give each other a kiss and they walk about, people are like, why are they gay? What's the reason? And it's like, well, some people are just gay. It just happens, you know? There's not, like, a reason for it. So I think that even when we're saying things, I think there's a term where it's like, not doing anything is just reinforcing the status quo. There's no such thing as an apolitical action. If you do nothing, it's it's an implicit endorsement of the status quo. So you're supporting it whether you want to or not. So I think it's important at early ages to wind it back, to understand like how even at early ages, even if we say we're not trying to confuse them with gendered stuff, we still kind of do.
Yeah.
I think a really good example of this, I play a lot of video games. I used to be a professional StarCraft player. When video games were first introduced to children, really for no reason, it was hardcore marketed towards young boys with the assumption that like girls don't like video games, they like to play with dolls. And if you look at, you're probably what, like 21 or something, or 20?
I'm 18.
You're 18, Jesus, okay. You don't see much anymore, but like there were, the ads that existed when I was growing up, I'm 34, for video games were like so hilariously like sexist. It was just like blatantly, like they didn't give a But it was just like the time that I grew up in. But as a result of that, like growing up, a lot of girls just didn't play video games because they were marketed heavily towards boys. But then we saw how that like that bleeds out into so many other areas of society too. When you look at like computer programming and stuff, when girls get to, it's not as bad anymore, but if we get to the point where when girls get to college and they want to enter like a comp sci class, all these boys have been playing video games, computer games their whole life, and women can't even compete in these areas. But like as time has gone on, we've seen that like, oh wait, women do like to play video games. They play Overwatch, they play Valorant. Like when it's a little bit more open and they have the opportunity to, like they'll gladly play. But we were so gendered in our youth that we didn't even think that like maybe that would be possible. So to bring that all the way back to your point, I think as much as we don't want to be, I think we have to be cognizant of things like gender roles and how we gender forms of play and everything for children, even at early ages, because even if we're not trying to do it, I think we inevitably end up doing it regardless.
Let me ask you this hypothetical, right? So say hypothetically 100,000 kids, 1% of them are trans, right? That's obviously not going to be the percentage.
Yeah, sure, I understand.
Would you think it's a benefit or hurting society as if you have, because of the way kids are influenced growing up, if you have 1.5% trans, the way they're influenced, right? 1.5 more originally or 0.5 less? Like if half of them, if I was...
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. So like...
Versus you influencing.
Yeah, yeah. I feel like if you really care about people, I feel like it's just a question of like epidemiology and stats. Yeah. So let's say that if we, the best we could get trans care, we made it so that instead of 1%, it was like 5%, yeah. Right? That's not acceptable. And that sucks for trans people. But at that point, then it's probably like, okay, if we can't explore anything better here, we kind of just have to wait until they turn 18. Like there's just, But if there is a way to bring that number down to where, let's say there's like 100 misdiagnosed kids every year, well, given the benefit to the 1,000 that are working, that ratio is probably more acceptable. But I feel like sometimes when you talk to people for their political ideas, they do this very weird thing where they're like, no margin of error here is acceptable. Like if you talk to somebody about BLM, you'll say like, how many innocent people should be killed by the cops every year? And people say that number should be zero. And it's like, it's never gonna be zero. There's gonna be somebody, right? Or if you talk to conservatives about trans kids, like how many trans kids can get misdiagnosed? That number has to be zero. Mm-hmm. We don't even do that for chemotherapy, right?
Yeah, yeah.
We don't do that for any drug in the United States. So it's like an unreasonable expectation that's set. But yeah, I mean, I would agree. You have to look at the numbers at the end of the day.
Yeah.
If you end up getting, you know, like 50% of people are desisting or detransitioning or whatever, then we have to take a step back and reanalyze our forms of care, like they've done in Scandinavia. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that like the detransitioning point is a big point because like when you have society endorsing it or being more okay with it, and if you see these kids that like, if a kid transitions when he's 12, 13 years old, you know, just be getting into puberty, the effect of him going back and forth by the time he's, you know, 13 maybe.
Could introduce a whole bunch of other problems. Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I got to get to business management.
Yeah. Good luck, buddy.
I appreciate the respectful conversation. Thanks for having me on your show.
Yeah. Have a good one, man. Gotcha. What's your position? Go ahead.
So I think it was regards to that sign over there about
conservatives hating trans people.
Conservatives. I'm assuming because like we can't look into the minds of, you know, people.
I can. Like, I'm the conservative reader.
Ooh, that's very interesting. Lucky for me, I'm not conservative, so there'll be a bit of mystery in our conversation.
Okay, that's fine.
I'm guessing that's like regarding the policies that our conservatives are pushing for is going to be your main argument. And whilst I don't know all the policies, I'm sure maybe you'll be able to name some that I don't know about, but I know one big one that they're pushing for involving trans people is the not allowing trans people into sports and stuff like that. And I personally don't have a problem with trans people going into sports. It's more, I have a problem with biological advantages. So for instance, like a trans female participating with other females might have a biological advantage, and I would have a problem with that. But if a trans male were to go into a sport with another male, provided they would have a disadvantage, but I wouldn't have a problem with them being in that support so long as they could keep up with all the other people in their field. So even though you're at a disadvantage, if you're so skilled, you can still keep up. I would have no problem with that. But if you have a biological advantage, and like then I may have a problem with that. If we were to find a way to eradicate the biological advantage, as far as to my knowledge, we don't have a way to do that yet to eradicate the biological.
Wait, is it mainly going to be focused on like trans athletes, or because I agree with you fully? Or
it doesn't need to. That was just
I agree.
My
that, like,
strongest
trans,
argument.
Yeah, I agree that for sports, trans sports and cis sports should be separated. Absolutely. Mm. I think that's pretty obvious. My issue with conservatives are a lot of it centers around how they talk about trans youth. I feel like conservatives aren't really interested in getting data-driven answers on how to properly address youth that are trans, but rather their goal is to just like eliminate it entirely. Mm-hmm. So I've asked a couple of conservatives that have come up here, like, let's say that I could 100% figure out who's trans when they're 12 years old. I've got a mind reader. I put the machine in their head. I push the button. They 100% can be told. Would you be okay with this person, like, having puberty blockers or gender-affirming care or whatever? And even at that, it's hard to get conservatives to agree to it. And it's like, why? Like, it feels like my objection to a lot of the trans youth stuff right now is that it seems hard to figure out who's really trans. So you get a lot of, like, desisters or a lot of detransitioners, which I think is obviously a problem. But if you could figure it out, like, wouldn't you want to? Shouldn't that be a thing you'd want to do? Mm-hmm. It seems like the only reason you could say no to that is because you just hate trans people. You just don't want it to exist at all. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that can't be the answer if you have compassion for that group of people.
Okay, so it's regarding around that specific
area. That's a big one, yeah.
Okay, so in regards to trans youth, my biggest issue would be when addressing trans issues with the younger audience would be like confusing them. Like, because as far as I know, we don't, I mean, I could be wrong. We don't have like a way to determine who's trans and who's not.
Yeah, I definitely agree with the confusion thing. Mm-hmm. But I mean, I think that's where the skill of like a good therapist that can like help to be like very critical of a child coming in is important.
So like,
I feel like people
classroom
thought the same thing about like gay stuff too. Like, oh, mm-hmm. we're going to turn our kids gay if we have like LGBT stuff in classrooms or LGBT mm-hmm. stuff in classrooms. I don't know if you're going to turn kids gay. The trans stuff is definitely a lot mm-hmm. more questionable, I would agree. But then like, shouldn't the goal be like to have like better studies for better therapies to figure out like who's actually trans or not?
I would agree with that. Better studies for better therapy, because I would agree with you in the sense that if there was a way to 100% determine who's trans and who's not, then like there'd be no reason to stop
it. Differently about it, yeah.
Other than but like, as to like how to go about that, I think it would be very hard, because like, are you like saying, you said in regards to therapy, for are you saying each child should have a therapist constantly? One, and I'm not trying to misrepresent you.
I'm saying, like, if a child thought they were trans,
curiosity.
If a child thinks they're trans, they should have a therapist that helps them to critically sort through mm-hmm. those feelings.
But
make sure it's
do
not
you
like
think
the,
that yeah. idea would come into their mind if not presented with that type of information in the first place?
I have no idea. But I mean, like, there, well, for some people, yeah, because mm-hmm. I mean, if you think that trans people are real, some people are going to be trans, and there's going to be something mm-hmm. weird going on, especially when they start going through puberty, where they're going to feel like they've mismatched their body hardcore, mm-hmm. and they need some type of help for that. So for those people, you'd hope to get them connected to the therapist that can help them figure out what's going on before they go through puberty to help them if they can. But mm-hmm. then there's going to be other kids that will hear about trans stuff and they're kind of depressed and they get like sucked into it and it's kind of dumb. But that's the goal, is to get a therapist to help like weed out mm-hmm. like the real trans people from the not as real trans people, right?
Yeah, I would definitely agree that a therapist would help, but I would disagree with the idea of trying to promote the idea that this could be possible. I'm not saying to hide it. You shouldn't hide it, because then, like, you know, kids see their parents hide. I don't think you should hide anything, but definitely I would disagree with the idea of propagating it as a possibility for everyone, because then all the kids might be thinking, oh, that could be me, and then it's going to get inside their head and confuse them.
Like gay and a lesbian stuff.
It could be.
And I feel like I feel like the conversation needs to be critical. It can't mm-hmm. just be like, oh, like everybody could be trans. It has to be like, oh, like some people might have these feelings, you know, some people mm-hmm. might feel this. And it'd have to be like age appropriate too. Like,
yeah.
Probably not a conversation you'd have with like a first grader or a second grader, maybe mm-hmm. like sixth, seventh, eighth grade, like middle school,
okay,
high
okay.
school, maybe.
I should have asked to clarify that too, mm-hmm. because I'm not going to lie, I was assuming you were talking about more elementary school
no,
kids.
No, I've got a 12-year-old son. If he came home at like 7 years old and said his teacher was telling him all about trans people, I'd probably like, you know, like, what the fuck? Yeah.
Okay. I would agree with maybe late middle school.
Sure.
Like maybe, I think I'd be okay with eighth grade as like a more appropriate topic, because at that point in your life, not everything will confuse you.
Yeah, you start to have like decent feelings at least around like your gender identity and stuff, especially as puberty mm-hmm. is starting out everything, yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I would definitely say that you should consult. Would you agree that if a child did start having that, since they are still fairly young to be making such a big decision, if they did start having that idea, do you think it would be agreeable for them to see a therapist before making such a big decision?
Yeah, I think it should be a requirement. If you're going to start doing any sort of medical transition or anything, I think there has to be some form of medical professional involved, I would say, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So, all right.
And then we would follow the data and we'd go from there. If it ends up being really successful, we pursue it. If it's really hard to weed out like who is or who isn't, then we'd figure out something different. Yeah.
I think that could be a viable, not solution, because we would need to test that first, but I would be open to that.
Okay.
All right.
Well, why you're not conservative, I guess.
No, I'm just kidding. But thank you for informing me about this.
All right. Thanks a lot. Nice appreciate it. You. Yeah, have a good one, man.
I disagree most. All the CBs that you're talking about, I would say, like, I disagree most with the one of, like, conservatives hate trans people.
Okay.
Because while on one hand, obviously, there's going to be conservatives who, like, have genuine animosity towards hatred, or right-wingers who have genuine animosity towards transgender people.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you go on 4chan, that's very self-evident. But, like, I think that so much has changed with just even within the last 10 years or even the past five years on the discourse and conversation about gender, that I think a lot of people, and especially conservatives, are like hesitant to embrace all of that. And I don't think that hesitancy to embrace this like idea that gender is like a social construct, or that you can be multiple genders at the same time, or no gender, or change gender at whim, it's like, I think that's coming as a shock to a lot of people, including conservatives, and not even conservatives at all. Like, I was talking with my family members who are like, you know, hardcore, you know, lifelong Democrats, or even further to the left, and they'll express the same reservations to me. And I feel like that doesn't constitute hatred.
Yeah, I mean, there are definitely people that are genuinely confused. I can buy that. I think the issue that I have is when it comes to like legislation, when it comes to conservative leaders talking about trans people, rather than figuring out like, hey, like, here's a line of dialogue, this is what I would say, I support this, right? There's probably an issue right now, especially on college campuses, especially with young women, all wanting to be fucking non-binary, okay? Because they dye their hair, they get a piercing, and now they're non-binary, okay? This is definitely like an issue that is happening in college. Definitely needs to be talked about, okay?
So do you think that's like a trend? And just like,
yes,
you know,
okay. Absolutely, that's a trend, okay?
Okay.
However, while I recognize that's a trend, I also recognize that there are very real trans people that do need like medical treatment and help like transitioning. I feel like a good conversation is like, what type of therapy do we have that identifies as early as possible who's actually trans versus who just has like other feelings and they're trendy, or they're looking for a community that like accepts them, et cetera, et cetera. But I feel like when conservatives talk about it, they're always just like, no, that shit, ban it all. It's social contagion, ban all of it. These people, drag shows are bad, children should never talk to a trans person. And that's what that's like the overwhelming amount of like feeling comes from. It doesn't feel like it's coming from a place of compassion. It feels like it's coming from a place of either fear, misunderstanding, or hatred.
So what I'd say to that is, I feel like especially when it comes to children, like you said, that the dialogue should be about like, how do we identify these feelings early on?
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that you mean like,
whether they're actually trans or just depressed, and then how do we help these people? Yeah.
Right. So like, I think that conservatives are concerned about like dealing with children, especially on the issue. And I think that that's a reasonable concern, in my opinion.
Yeah, where the fuck was this outrage though for pageants? There's such a huge pageantry culture in this stuff. I know you are. That's fine that you are. 100%. And now when I bring it up to conservatives, they'll all say they're against it. But like, there were names of somebody wrote up Toddlers and Tiaras. I know there was one in 2013 where there was a really popular reality TV show about like moms and their daughters and getting them ready for pageants and shit. I wish I could remember the names of these fucking shows. But for a while, it was like pretty trendy in the United States. I don't remember. I didn't hear any like massive conservative pushback against all this shit about like sexualizing kids and stuff. And I don't know. I'm not trying to say that like that's okay, or that because that's okay, they should be gay, et cetera. I'm just saying that when somebody has selective outrage about something, it makes me wonder, right? Like if let's say like a white kid walks into a store and he's got baggy pants, and then another white kid, and then another white kid, and then a black kid comes in and somebody's like, you're not allowed in here with those baggy pants. It's like, is it really about the baggy pants? It doesn't feel like it. And so I wonder sometimes for the conservatives, like, is it really about like the influence on the youth, or is this just like your new kind of pet project to be like anti-trans through? Because it seems like you didn't care about sexualization of minors when it was happening so much before, even on reality TV. That's my feeling about it.
I think that's a fair point. I do think that's a fair point, that like the pageant shit, like, should have been like, had way more outrage towards it. And I mean, we only know in retrospect of like the damage that's done to those kids. Like, you know what I'm saying? And I think that, but at the same time, it's like that behavior of the pageant show of like kids, I think that's like, that was so normalized in society for like a long time, like even to the early 2000s. Like, I don't really hear about that anymore, but like it was so normalized. And I think that people in general just weren't like attuned to that. But when it came to like dealing with like transgenderism, where it's like, okay, like you have, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but there's people who would like argue that children who feel that they are like transgender, feel that they're in the wrong body, should receive like gender affirming care, or receive like medical treatment to help them.
Yeah, there's a group of people like the self-ID crowd, where it's like if a child says it, they should instantly get it. And it's like, obviously that's stupid, right? We need like a better vetting process, I think.
And I think that conservatives are, I think conservative opposition to that and the things that lead to that are reasonable. Like, I feel like, I don't feel like that's hatred. And I think that
if I heard conservatives talking about finding better ways to identify real trans people, I would believe it more, but it's just they always feel like they just want to get rid of all of it. Like when I hear about, like, especially for trans youth, it's always like, get rid of it, make it illegal, no medical intervention, even with parental consent, no medical intervention. And then I feel like at that point, it's like, fuck, like, do you just not believe that anybody can know they're trans before 18? Because there's probably some people that know that, right? And now you basically said, like, fuck you, go through puberty, get fucked, and then at 18, try to figure shit out. And by then, for a lot of, especially trans women, it's kind of like too late at that point. You're kind of fucked. But.
Well, I mean, it definitely ties into the bigger conversation of whether transgenderism as an identity is even like, or not, it's not an identity, but like whether
it's a real thing or not.
Yeah, whether it's real or not. And obviously conservatives don't believe that it is a legitimate thing. I mean,
sure,
like, you have
like, well, they also for a while didn't believe that like being gay is a real thing, right?
Yeah like Matt Walsh, like, you know, he dropped the whole documentary that was like, oh, what is a woman, and that's basically the whole like
Yeah, I agree,
construction of the issue. So they clearly don't believe that it's a real thing. But even with that, I feel like, okay, it's like, and I mentioned this earlier, like, it's like the confusing aspect of it for a lot of people, where it's like, just within like my life, because growing up, I was aware of like transgender people. Like, I knew that, like, my family was very like open to that kind of thing. Like, just where I grew up, and I grew up in New York City, like, I was like exposed to a lot of it. Like, one of the earliest childhood memories, my grandma, also at the party, she like introduced me to like this like drag queen friend of hers. I was like, oh wow, I didn't even know that was a thing, you know what I'm saying? So, but like, I think that, like, it used to be a thing of like, okay, there's people out there who are like men and then feel like they're women, and so they go through these like things to become like women. And then there's the opposite, where women want to become men, whatever. But then when it comes to the thing of like, there's like an infinite amount of genders, and then there's and you could be multiple genders at once. I feel like the conservative concern is that's confusing for children, and that having that outlined to children will confuse them and actually make the problem worse. And that's where the
sure. And I can understand that. Yeah. But like I said, I wish that when they treaded these issues, it was with a bit more compassion for people that might be trans. But then if they totally don't believe in transness at all, then I would say that kind of agrees with the prompt that they probably hate trans people because they don't think they're real.
But if you like don't believe someone is a certain identity that they identify with, like, is that
kind of a hatred for their identity, right?
Or is that just like believing that, like, I just don't think that's true. Like, I don't think that's accurate. Like,
I feel like almost everybody that has that identity would feel kind of hated.
Oh, I don't deny that they'd be hurt by that claim, but I'm saying, like,
if somebody said that being gay wasn't real, would you say that they hate gay people, or would you say they just don't believe in gayness?
Well, I think that it depends on the person and the circumstance, but like the claim itself, I don't think is like a hateful claim. And I'll tell you why, because me personally, like, my belief of like sexuality, and this is a different conversation, but like, I don't believe people are born gay, but I also don't believe people are born straight. I don't believe like you're
probably some combination of genetic and environmental factors that determine your sexuality as you grow up. Probably true. Yeah.
Right. And that's why as my opinion of it, and I don't believe that like a lot of like sex labels on sexuality can perfectly encapsulate like someone's sexual feelings. So like, you could interpret what I just said as like, I don't really believe like being gay is real or sure. being straight is real. It's like, I don't think that like asserting, even though like people are going to be honestly hurt by the statement, like, I don't think like asserting, well, I don't really know if that's like, you can really do that. I don't really know if you can like change your gender. Like, I don't know if that's like, hatred. Now, I know that we know now that you probably know more about it than I do, but like,
yeah, I understand
like,
what you mean. Yeah,
but like, we know that like transgender people who are, feel like are male to female or female to male, like, their brains, like, if I'm right, like they're like, they actually like have like a neurological thing where it's like
their brains are matching in different areas a little bit more for to the edge. Yeah, yeah, they're different. They're unique brains. Yeah, for sure. So and I then it's hard to say if those brains are shaped through social factors, because your brain can change, right? Like PTSD will change like the structure of the hippocampus, your amygdala, I think parts of your prefrontal cortex, like there are parts of your brain will change in response to environmental stimuli. So yeah.
Okay.
But yeah. Okay. Do you feel like, I'm curious, do you feel like you could have a discussion like this in class? And if you're wondering, do you think, would you get a bigger pushback from professors or from students?
It depends on the class. If I was in like, I'm in liberal arts, mm-hmm. so, but I'm in like economics and I'm in, you know, mm-hmm. classical studies, but there's certain majors where if I was taking like sexology, for example, like, and I said what I just said, like, I'd probably get a lot of pushback from both students and professors.
Gotcha.
I think that if, you know, like these conversations like do come up in like classical studies major where like I'm learning about like how gender and sexuality was conceived of in like ancient times and like
sure.
we're learning about that, like those conversations will come up, and I think that if I brought it up, like I would probably just get more pushback from like my professor. Like if I said like I don't know the context where that would come up, like I would just like assume like I would get more pushback from professor. Like I don't think I would
okay speak, yeah. Interesting. Okay, yeah. Just curious. All right, cool. Well, hey, listen, I appreciate the conversation.
Me too.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, man. Have a good one.